Morning.
Morning.
Welcome home. There's a place for you here. Yesterday, there was some strong thunder out where but not much else, but it did make me mindful of how often we've had storms this past summer, which made me mindful that we serve a God who can calm the storm, no matter how violent. And in his earthly ministry, that miracle where Jesus stilled the waves is one of our stained glass windows. It's here on the left, and it's the third one up from the back. It's called Jesus Stilling the Waves. And it gives us this morning's call to worship, because each of these stained glass windows has a verse associated with it. And the verse for this one is our call to worship. It's Mark 4, verse 39. This is the ESV version. And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Please join me in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you that we can claim your peace. We thank you for bringing us together, and we ask in the calm that you provide that you touch the words of Pastor Andrew, shape our hearts and our spirits to better serve you. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I invite you to stand. We'll be singing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Thank you.
folks and look at it. And one thing I'd like to encourage you to do is take the bulletin, tear out the connection card. If you have any prayer requests or anything that you'd like to share with us and prayer concerns, or you're just here and you'd like us to contact you, please fill it out and put it in the offering plate as it comes by later on during the services. If you're new here this morning, we'd like to welcome you. As David said, you all have a place. And we have donuts after the service. If you go down the hallway here to your right, my left, and then take the next left, we'll have donuts. And then you can smell them, and you can see the regulars, you know, start going down there in a quick run to get those donuts. So have some donuts with us and a time of talking to each other and sharing. Next week, we have a designated offering. The designated offering is for the Maui relief of the situation in Maui. It's going through Operation Blessing to help support the Maui. So next week, come in, we'll have a special offering just for that. We have a lot of things for the youth, and so these are highlighted here. For example, down the very bottom, we have the Awana kickoff is on the 20th. So that's on the 20th. We have Sunday school. It just started like last week. Even though we're looking for Sunday school teachers, we have Sunday school for all the youth and the military campus youth. Also, the meetings are on Wednesdays from 1800 to 1945 at the Herald Youth Center. So a lot of youth programs. For the adults, we have three Sunday school classes. This shows that the Sunday school class, that we're going from the basics to heaven. But we're not going to have heaven quite yet. Heaven's next week, okay? Because this week, where we show heaven, which is Dr. Dean Nowitzki's class, back here in the corner, they're actually going to have a film today on Paul the Apostle of Christ. But you have the Apostle of Christ, but you have the basic taught by Jim Harbridge, the habit, which is going to be Paul the Apostle of Christ, and then we have the Alpha, which is done by Randy Klinger. So please look at those three. We encourage you to come. They start at 9:45 and 10 o'clock over in the other building up the hill, the Frontier Chapel. On the, make sure I got the right dates, 29th and 30th of September, we have the Barbecue Bonanza. Barbecue Bonanza is a great time to learn how to make great barbecue. It'll be better than what you can get downtown, but we'll show you how to do barbecue, teach you how to do it, you'll actually cook and be judged on the barbecue. And then, best of all, we'll eat that barbecue. So the 29th and the 30th, please feel free to come to that. We'd love to have you as a part of this. Any other thing, anything I missed? Where's Carl? I missed anything, Carl, you know?
Sounds great, sir.
Anything? Okay. Anything I'm missing? Anybody else? Well, we are so glad to have you here this morning. I'd like to encourage you to stand up, just turn around, and just say hi to somebody else sitting around you as we get ready to do the next song.
Welcome back, Trina. How are you doing, sweetie? Doing good? Good to see you again. Thanks for the message you sent while you were on the way.
Hey,
how are you doing?
God answered a lot of prayers.
Yeah.
Really blessed.
Awesome. Sorry.
Hey, sweetie girl.
Tina, when I open my
watch
message,
do you
want to watch?
Thank you.
our Savior and our Lord. So Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
You may be seated. Please join me in a brief time of prayer. Lord God, we thank you that you hear us, that you are with us now. Lord, that you have seen fit to have relationships with us. You are Creator, the one, like we said earlier, who stills the waves, the storms, both in the world and also in our hearts. Lord God, as we come before you now during this time of worship and song and hearing of your word, giving of our gifts, proclaiming your name so that we might be equipped, empowered, and encouraged to go out as your witnesses in the rest of our week. We ask, Holy Spirit, that you would be with us here now. Help us to lay aside, to lay at your feet all those things that cloud our hearts and our minds, or the burdens that we carry, that you have asked, that you have truly commanded us to give to you. That we might take up your yoke upon us, for your yoke is easy, your burden is light. So help us, Lord, to come before you now. Help us come before you, Lord, in our brokenness, in our imperfections, in our struggles. Help us to come before you with our sin and confess it so gladly to you, because you receive us gladly. Lord, help us to bring all of our needs before you as well. And lift up our country. Lord, with all the divisiveness that we experience today, Lord, our only hope truly is you and none else. Lord, be with our leaders. Be with both our leaders, both in our government, also the leaders that are in our churches, Lord, that they might represent you well. That they might be unwavering in their commitment to you, Lord Jesus, and winsome in the way that they might draw others by your Spirit to you. Lord Jesus, I ask that you would continue to bless our church around the world. Be with those right now who are suffering persecution for your name's sake. Be with our brothers and sisters here in this country as we all gather together to celebrate you, Lord, to proclaim our hope that we have in you, the resurrection. And help us, O God, around our country, here in this area, here on this installation, that we might be a light. That your light might shine brightly through us. That we would not hide that light, but that we would be glad and obedient to you, to serve you, and serving others. God, as we continue to worship here, I ask that you be with Andrew as he prepares his heart and mind, as he continues to seek you for your wisdom and your grace, that you would speak through him, that we would hear your word preached, and that we would walk away from here meditating on your goodness, your greatness, your graciousness, and your gloriousness nature that you present to us in through your word, ultimately revealed in our Savior Jesus Christ. And now, Lord, even as we prepare to give our treasures, help us to do so with glad and thankful hearts, trusting you.
Thank you, madam. That is very kind.
All that we are, for the sake, Lord God, of all that you are. that we do so with a heart that prays as you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please remain standing for the reading.
Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, They have no wine. And Jesus said to her, Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, Do whatever he tells you. Now there were 6 stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, Fill the jars with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast. So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, Everyone serves the good wine first, and when people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now. This is the first of his signs Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The word of the Lord. Please be seated.
Good morning. See you all this morning. Chaplain Andrew Meilenberg, fairly new here, been here a few weeks for those of you that I haven't met yet. Today we'll be in the story of Jesus turning the water into wine. Now, for me, when I typically hear this story with young soldiers, it's usually one of the few that they know in the Bible. You can probably guess why. Usually followed by some sort of pronouncement, well, Jesus turned water into wine, so it's okay, whatever I do on Friday night. There's a little bit of humor in that, and some tongue-in-cheek. When we look at this passage, when we look at this story, when we look at it in the context of the book of John, the Gospel of John, this story means so much more than just that. It's not a moral story about what we should do or not do. It's about the difference between transactional relationship and relational restoration. And that's a pretty significant thing when you think about it. I Googled transactional relationship this morning, thinking it would be hard to find that term on Google. Turned out the entire first page and several below that were descriptions of transactional relationship. So what I want you to do this morning, for just a moment with me, is close your eyes. Think about a transactional relationship that you had. A relationship where you had to do something, and then that other person would do something. And maybe it felt like you only ever got a phone call or a text message. Something was needed from you. You open your eyes back up. What did you think of? How did you feel? What comes to mind for me when I think of that question is growing up in my household, my parents would tell me that they unconditionally loved me. And I know that to be true, and yet I always felt like I needed to perform in order for that love to be valid. And that's not a slight on my parents. That's our culture. You perform well at work, you're valuable. If you don't, you're fired, unless you work for the Army, in which case you get 6 or 8 months more. But especially in the Army context, we're in a performance-based environment. Our families exist in performance-based environments very, very often. In transactional relationship, although we know in our mind it's not how we should be conducting ourselves, our culture, our world, our society doesn't act that way. And we all are susceptible to transactional relationship in some form or fashion. And when we look at the Israelite nation, we look at the people in the Bible, we see that they had devolved into transactional relationship with God. The Pharisees had the law, they had the teachings of the prophets, and yet, all they talk about is if you obey the law, then God will find you righteous. If you disobey the law, you're a sinner, you're unclean, you're broken, you're not worthy to come into the door of the temple. And I will add to you that even today in the church, we probably believe that in some form or fashion. That when we walk through the doors of the church, we have to be good enough for God. But what I'll tell you when we start thinking about why Jesus came and what Jesus set out to do, especially as we look at this miracle of water into wine, it was to offer us something much, much, much better than that. So if you start in the book of John, really we have to gain an understanding of the themes of what John is really getting after. And some of that goes into the very big picture wave tops of how the book was written, how it was sent out among the area at the time. And something interesting when I was doing the study for this message is that when we look at the book of John, we don't have necessarily the original version currently. The oldest manuscripts they have are about 90 AD. And they're pretty sure those are copies. And so when we start to look into the history of that, we start to gain an understanding that John probably added a couple things towards the end. And I'll point us to John chapter 20, verse 30, to kind of kick off this understanding of what John is trying to accomplish in all the pieces that are here in this gospel. And it reads in verse 30, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Now that reads like a conclusion to the book to me. The end of the book, we're done, close the gospel, believe in Jesus, go do great things. And then chapter 21 starts. And it's interesting as you look at the history of the church of why that probably came to be. And it sounds like a little bit of an odd connection, but we have to look at the church in Ephesus of Asia Minor. Paul had established this church, he'd been pastoring this church. If we look back through the book of Acts and some of the other traditions, we see that it was probably the place he spent most of his time, estimated 3 years. And then Paul ends up being sent to Rome, and he's killed. So they send Peter out to the church at Ephesus, and he pastors the church at Ephesus, and then Peter's killed. If you were a church, and you were a growing church, you were isolated from Jerusalem a little bit, but you've just seen your church leaders, people who were important to your community, killed by the Roman Empire, that would be a tough thing, just the grieving aspect alone. But then you start to think of, as Christianity is taking hold, were there doubts? Were there concerns about whether Jesus was in fact who he said he was? So they sent John out to pastor the church in Ephesus. And I believe that this is why chapter 21 is in there, because it's talking about the restoration of Peter. It's talking about a prophecy by Jesus about how Peter is going to die. And we see in 2 Peter, if we fast forward up there, we see that Peter also mentions, hey, this is going to be recorded that Jesus said this. So John includes chapter 21 for a very important reason, to give the people yet another piece of evidence and proof that Jesus was in fact who he said he was. He was the Son of God. He's also fully man. And when we look at that theme within the rest of the context of the book of John, it becomes a very important thing to keep in mind as we look back to John chapter 2. That everything in this book, John put in there very intentionally. He says in verse 30 of chapter 20 that there could be many, many things. You wouldn't be able to fill all the books and all the libraries with the things Jesus did, is what is said about Jesus' miracles. John says it could not all be recorded. Why did he pick the things that are in the book of John to be in the book of John? The water and wine was not a simple miracle. References at you, and this will be fairly quick. Each of these could be their own sermon, of course, so we won't go too far down the rabbit hole. But the first seven passages I'll point out, this is to grasp the themes in the book of John that show the significance of why this miracle is so important. The first seven are related, really, a message towards the Gentile population. The Greeks' philosophy, who you say you are, gave them an indication of your identity. John chapter 6, verse 35, Jesus says he's the bread of life. He meets the needs of the people. We see that throughout the Old Testament, the New Testament. I'm sure we have testimony in here today of where Jesus has met a need. John chapter 8, verse 12, I am the light of the world. Jesus exposes lies, provides the truth. John chapter 10, verse 7, I am the door to the sheep. And that's a very significant one. We'll come back to it and reference a little bit here as we look at the kingdom of God within these miracles, within these themes. The Pharisees had an exclusive faith. You were only allowed in with certain things. Jesus is offering an inclusive faith. The door to the sheep was letting everybody in. John chapter 10, verse 17, I am the good shepherd. That's a throwback to Ezekiel 34, where he's talking about a prophecy of God providing Israel with a shepherd to care for the flock. Here's where we get into some of the really weighty things of who Jesus was. John 11, verse 25, I am the resurrection and the life, eternal life. John chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life, salvation. John 15, 1, I am the true vine. Once you are saved, once you're fully vested in Christ, once you have identity restoration, once you're in true godly relationship with Jesus, he's going to make you useful to go out and do stuff. And even when we look at the theology behind heaven, the kingdom of God, we're not just going to be sitting on a cloud with a harp. At least I hope not. Then John gets into what Jesus does. This is for the Jewish population. The John chapter 2 miracle, water into wine. Jesus transforms your life. John 4, verses 46 through 54, long distance healing. He says, your family members heal. Go. We can take Jesus at his word, not just what happens. John chapter 5, verse 1, the lame man at Bethesda. Jesus helps those who have no one. I doubt a little bit too. It's not Jesus helps those who help themselves. Jesus helps those who have no one and nothing. John chapter 6, verses 6 through 13, Jesus feeds the 5,000. Little becomes much when Jesus touches it. John chapter 6, 15 to 21, Jesus calms the storm. Jesus has power over everything. John chapter 9, 1 through 12, he heals a blind man. He puts the mud on his eyes. He gave us life by lighting up our dark hearts. I don't know about you, but my heart is not always as light as I hope it could be. And Jesus comes in, provides light to that. John chapter 11, verses 41 through 46, he raises Lazarus. Jesus is king over death. When we look at those intentional stories that are included in the book of John, we start to understand that everything is in there for a reason. When we look at the addition of the story of Peter, we understand that John is trying to tell the people of the day, but also us, that everything that Jesus said and did was important. Is it important? And as we get back to John chapter 2, we can read it with a new lens because we realize that everything in this passage is foreshadowing what's about to come. Starting right there in verse 1. The third day, a wedding took place in Cana of Galilee. But what else happened on the third day? Think forward to Easter, the resurrection. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. Now, this is obviously an important event. I've never been given a plus 12 at a wedding. Any of you? You get a plus one, right? No kids. It's an important wedding. Jesus' mother obviously had a close relationship with the family. All of Jesus' disciples come. And then this moment happens. The wine is gone. And it's embarrassing. I'm sure many of us have heard this story before. If you haven't, it's embarrassing. If you're throwing a party, you run out of stuff. If I invite some people over and I bought one bag of chips for about 30 people, it's probably going to be a pretty sad party and everybody's going to go home early. And so Jesus' mother says, hey, let's see if we can fix this. I know who my son is. Mary experienced the miraculous nature of Christ's incarnation when she became pregnant. All the exposure to the angels, the birth story. She knows that Jesus can accomplish something of significance and of value for this family. But what she's not thinking of, and Jesus highlights in the next verse here, is that he's not just saving a family from embarrassment. He's not just speaking to this status quo of faith that people have been wrapped up in for centuries at this point. He's offering something better. And so in verse 4, he says, woman, why do you involve me? Now, I don't know about you on that line, but if I told my mother, woman, I would probably be grounded even at the age I'm at now. So as a Western reader, that line's a little challenging for us. Woman, why do you involve me? It almost seems disrespectful. But I think John is using that terminology explicitly, just as Jesus did. Where Jesus is starting his public ministry and he's stepping away from his identity as Mary's son. He's saying, I am going to go be the light and the savior to the entire world, to include Mary. Jesus replied, my hour's not yet come. It's foreshadowing. It's looking forward to the sacrifice on the cross, the death on that cross, the resurrection, the forgiveness of sins. And then eventually, all this often included at a later time, the coming of the Holy Spirit, the empowerment for ministry to build the kingdom of God, to fulfill the Great Commission and participate in what God's doing in the world. His mother, being his mother, said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. I could totally see my mom disregarding the statement and telling me to do that as well. And we see these ceremonial washing jars, and this is where we see the duality of what was and what Jesus is accomplishing. Baptism wasn't a new thing when the New Testament came about. Ceremonial washing was not a new thing. The Jewish people would do it on a regular basis, and often it was also added for the forgiveness of sins. Now, I hope everybody in here has showered at least in the last 24 to 48 hours, but I'll tell you, if I showered today and I decide not to ever do it again, you probably all would not like that decision. It was the same thing with the Israelite nation. They would baptize for sins, they would sacrifice in the temple, and then they'd go out and sin again. Then they'd have to baptize again, they'd have to ceremonial wash again, they would have to sacrifice again. So when we look at these jars that are used for ceremonial washing, they're really representing, hey, there's this thing, and water's good. I need water to live. But it's not the end goal. So Jesus said to the servants, fill them with water, they filled them up, and then he told them to draw some out and take it to the master of the feast. And this is where we see the kind of pivotal moment of this miracle. They take the water, turn it into wine to the master of the feast. And he says this line here down in verse 10. Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best until now. And that's vitally significant when we think about what that means in terms of the kingdom of God. Jesus is saying, hey, you have this status quo, you have this transactional relationship with God, you have this thing that is binding people up in sin. They're trying to live up to rules that they'll never be able to live up to. Well, I'm going to offer you something better in the sacrifice on the cross for sin. And it doesn't invalidate baptism, we still baptize. It doesn't invalidate the law. There's still a standard. Jesus is saying, I can heal you from your sin and brokenness. I can provide relational restoration to you. We can make this about your identity instead of what you do or don't do. In verse 11, that passage is so encouraging to me. When John just tops it off, when Jesus did what Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of his signs, starting his public ministry, through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. And that's a pretty cool line for a variety of reasons, but when we look back to that interplay, the water into wine, the foreshadowing of what's about to come, we can start to understand who Jesus is through this story. And that's what John wants us to do, is to understand that Jesus is offering something that's complete counterculture where we've been up to this point. We circle back to transactional relationship. I would say that the church often does this. We make it about the rules, we make it about checking the block, we make it about trying to figure out how to live righteously, and then we apply cheap grace to it. Oh man, I failed today, so I'm just going to ask Jesus for forgiveness, and then I'll feel better about myself. When we talk about relational restoration, we're talking about something that's so much bigger than that. We're talking about Jesus reaching into the very core of your identity and changing who you are as a human being and making you part, a citizen of the kingdom of God. Causes us to live differently. Restoration is bigger than just you. Sometimes we wonder what we're restoring to, and I think Genesis gives us a very, very clear answer to that. We paint the picture of Adam and Eve. They lived in perfection. They didn't have to worry about a tornado and dark clouds on the horizon like I was sitting there in my garage looking at the other day. Perfect temperature, plenty of food. God walked with them in the garden every single day. And we lost that
during the fall. We lost that through sin. We're under the curse now. And we're trying to earn our way back into that every single day. And Jesus tells us that is not how you do that. He's saying, abide in me. He's saying, be part of me. He's saying, change your identity to be aligned with me. And when we start to look at what the disciples do through the book of Acts, when we start to look at how the church radically transforms the entire region at the time, we see people who are willing to be persecuted, who are being willing to be martyred for their faith. That's not lukewarm, that's not cheap grace, that's not transactional. Their very identity had been changed by the exposure to Jesus. And then they went and told others through the Great Commission, as they went out and baptized others, they discipled others, they spread the good news, and then Jesus changed those people too through the power of the Holy Spirit. As they transitioned, they were no longer citizens of Rome. They were citizens of the kingdom of God. How do we apply this to ourselves today? I would argue that a lot of churches, a lot of Christians find themselves with one foot in each kingdom. I'm sitting there wanting to have all the things of the world and be part of the world and be of the world. While my other foot, oh yeah, I'm part of the kingdom. Yeah, are we really sold out to be part of the kingdom? Have we really dropped everything as Jesus commanded his disciples to do and followed him? We given up on comfort? Have we given up on trying to prove ourselves and said, Jesus, transform my identity and let me be who you've called me to be? Or do we come to church on Sunday? We take communion. We say we're sorry for our sin. And assume that's what actually makes us righteous in the eyes of God. I'll tell you this morning, nothing will make you righteous except for the blood of Christ shed on the cross for your sin. Nothing will give you true fulfillment and participation in the kingdom of God aside from fully investing in what Jesus has called you to do, being who Jesus has called you to be, stepping out on faith everywhere you go, knowing that you have been called for a very specific mission by God for a very specific reason, to be part of something bigger than yourself. If you're sitting here today and you haven't thought of the kingdom of God, of what Jesus did for you in that light, I would encourage you to take some time this next week. Are you truly living in relational restoration? Are you in a transactional relationship with the creator of the universe? Are you pursuing the thing, the status quo that's been there? Or are you finding something better through Jesus Christ? As we prepare to leave this space today, let's go before God in prayer and just pray for those around us that they will continue to understand what their identity is in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Lord, as we prepare to leave this space, just speak to our hearts. Bring your Holy Spirit into each of our places, in this building, in our homes, in our places of work, in our vehicles, in our families. Provide us the relational restoration that you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ. For those that this is not quite yet clicked, Lord, just give them the heartfelt understanding of who you are and what you provide. Help us all to daily take up our cross and follow you, and to live as citizens of the kingdom of God, not citizens of the earth here. We thank you for who you are and what you do for us. In your name, amen.
I invite you to stand and sing with me. I love to tell the story. I love to tell the story. Number 297. Mm-hmm.
As you go from this place, know that Jesus loves you, that he offers relational restoration, that he has a place for each and every one of you in his kingdom, no matter where you've been, no matter who you are, no matter what you've done. He's looking to bring you in today. So go forth from this place, forever give use of the gospel in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.